A very good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item of business today is to consider whether to take item 8, which is our draft annual report, in private. Are we all agreed? Okay. Thank you. So our next item of business is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum, which is the Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill. And I'm pleased to welcome the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, Tom Arthur, and two of his officials to the meeting. Three officials to the meeting this morning. Mr. George Burgess, Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy. Mr. George Dixon, Team Leader, Defence, Security and Disrupt at the Scottish Government. And Ms. Kirsty Anderson, Solicitor with the Scottish Government Directorate for Legal Services. And I refer members to paper one. So just before we start our questioning on the LCM, I just wanted to make members aware that late yesterday afternoon, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee published their report on the LCM, which is the 32nd report of 2023. And this report was circulated to members yesterday afternoon, just as soon as it was published. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee's report makes a series of points, mostly around the powers in the UK government's bill, which would see regulations being made by a UK Secretary of State in devolved areas with the consent of Scottish ministers. So the DPLR committee want to ensure that the Scottish Parliament has an opportunity to scrutinise the Scottish Minister's consent decisions when these situations arise. So on that note, I will now invite the Minister to make some opening remarks on the LCM and then we'll move to questions. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and thank you for the opportunity to address members on the Legislative Consent Memorandum for the UK Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill. The Legislative Consent Memorandum has been corrected by a letter from the Scottish Government on 19 May 2023, so that paragraph 115 makes reference to Amendment 77L instead of Amendment 77B. The bill is the second part of a UK-wide legislative package to prevent the abuse of UK corporate structures and to tackle economic crime. The Scottish Government is fully supportive of the policy intention of the bill. It follows on from the Economic Crime, Transparency and Enforcement Act 2022, which received royal assent on 15 March 2022. The Scottish Government welcomes the constructive engagement with UK Government ministers and officials on aspects of the bill and subsequent UK Government amendments which impact on devolved areas. The legislative consent motion recommends consent for the majority of the bill. It also recommends that consent for some of the provisions is withheld meantime, in the hope that these can be resolved through ongoing engagement with the UK Government. This is because Amendment 77L, which introduces new Schedule 6 and Section 303Z42, as inserted by Schedule 7, both fall within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament and would provide a power to create regulations without consent. The Scottish Government remains acutely aware of the Scottish Parliament's consistent view on delegated powers which relate to devolved matters. There has been progress on this topic in some parts of the bill in relation to registers of overseas entities and Scottish limited partnerships, and we continue to explore the issue with the UK Government. The policy objective of the Register of Overseas Entities is to tackle money laundering by shedding light on who benefits from that property. It is a UK-wide register. The Scottish Government is committed to improving transparency of those who own and control land in Scotland. We fully supported UK-wide emergency legislation introduced following the invasion of Ukraine last year, which established the register. This bill includes provision to address gaps and loopholes that have been identified since the register was introduced last year. Most of the amendments are technical and procedural, and a number are designed specifically as anti-avoidance measures to close loopholes that have been identified in relation to trusts. These are exactly the kind of measures we support in order to ensure the register of overseas entities captures the most opaque of entities. Elements of the register are within the Scottish Parliament's legislative competence and therefore require consent. Although fully supportive of the policy and issues these provisions address, at this stage the draft legislative consent motion recommends withholding consent to one of the provisions introduced at Lords Grand Committee by Amendment 77L. This is because it contains a power for the Secretary of State to make regulations without any requirement to seek consent of the Scottish Ministers and without any restrictions placed around its use. Limited partnerships, including Scottish limited partnerships, while used for a range of legitimate business purposes, have also been exploited by criminals for illegitimate purposes, such as money laundering. The changes made by the bill include the introduction of a power for the courts to wind up limited partnerships in the public interest where it is just and equitable. For Scottish limited partnerships, such action by a court would come about following a petition by the Secretary of State with the consent of the Scottish Ministers or following a petition by the Scottish Ministers. This is a welcome addition to the arsenal to tackle the abuse of limited partnerships. There will be a regulation-making power enabling the Secretary of State, with the consent of the Scottish Ministers, to make provisions governing the process of winding up of Scottish limited partnerships in the public interest. The bill also includes provisions relating to the winding up of dissolved partnerships, notification requirements where they are concurrent proceedings, and regulation-making powers to amend such notification requirements. The Scottish Government supports strengthening transparency requirements and action to tackle the abuse of limited partnerships, including Scottish limited partnerships, by expanding winding up provisions. I will now turn to the justice-related provisions in the bill. These are principally intended to strengthen powers to tackle economic crime and illicit finance. The Scottish Government shares those policy goals. The bill amends the Solicitor Scotland Act 1980 to remove the existing statutory limit on financial penalties that can be imposed by the Scottish Solicitors Discipline Tribunal for disciplinary matters relating to economic crime offences defined by the bill. This change provides for a greater deterrent against money laundering and economic crime in respect of legal services in Scotland, whilst also providing for parity with England and Wales. The bill includes provisions to strengthen the Proceeds of Crime Act, POCA, to tackle the unlawful use of crypto assets. It also aims to make it easier for relevant businesses to share customer information with each other for the purposes of preventing, investigating and detecting economic crime by disciplining civil liability for breaches of confidentiality where information is shared for this purpose. It also aims to reduce unnecessary reporting by business and new powers for law enforcement to obtain further information to tackle money laundering and terrorism financing. It provides additional powers to law enforcement agencies so they are able to seize, freeze and ultimately recover crypto assets, which are the proceeds of crime or associated with illicit activity. This includes money laundering, fraud, ransomware attacks or terrorist financing. The bill updates both the criminal confiscation and civil recovery regimes under Part 3 and 5 of the Proceeds of Crime Act 2002 to ensure that it can be used effectively to tackle serious organised crime in relation to crypto assets and crypto asset related items. Clause 167 of the bill introduces Schedule 6, which amends POCA to make provision in connection with crypto assets and criminal confiscation orders following a criminal conviction in relation to persons who benefit from criminal conduct. Clause 168 of the bill introduces Schedule 7, which amends POCA to create a new civil recovery regime to recover crypto assets and crypto asset-related items which have been obtained through unlawful conduct. Importantly, the provisions include powers to seize exempt property with senior officer approval if there are reasonable grounds to suspect it is a crypto asset related item, such as laptops, wallet keys, and codes. This will assist law enforcement to access the crypto assets. The initial detention period is 48 hours and then subject to further detention periods of 14 days at a time with court approval. POCA is a UK-wide regime which relates to reserved and devolved matters. For example, money laundering and drug trafficking is reserved to the UK Parliament, but fraud is devolved. As the general approach to POCA is to keep a consistent regime across the UK jurisdictions, the Scottish Government believe it is sensible for these amendments to POCA to be made by the UK Parliament. Separate from POCA provisions, there is a new failure to prevent fraud offence. The Scottish Government is keen for the new protections for victims to be realised in Scotland. Many of the organisations operate across the whole of the UK and the Scottish Government considers the UK legislation is proportionate. On that, Convener, I will conclude and I hope that the committee will support the legislative consent motion.
Thanks very much, Minister. A lot covered there. So I think we'll just move straight to questions. I'll open up. Clearly, the sort of extent and the reach of the provisions of the bill is very welcome. It's good to see some much-needed changes to the sort of legislative provision around preventing economic crime and protecting our sort of corporate infrastructure, with particular reference to Scotland. I wonder if I can just pick up on a couple of the provisions. The first one, I think I've got my head round. I've spent quite a bit of time reading through the papers ahead of our meeting today, and it relates to the provision that will create new exemptions from the principal money laundering offences to reduce unnecessary reporting by businesses carrying out transactions on behalf of their customers. So I'm assuming that's possibly where that compliance is perhaps a little bit disproportionate. And I can certainly bring you in and then I'll come to a second point, if I may.
We want to come in on that point, George?
Really just looking at a wee bit more of an explanation as to what that means.
Right. Money laundering, while they're covered by the bill, is actually a reserved area, so not one that is covered by the legislative consent memorandum or the motion. So it's not an area. We work with the UK government in relation to money laundering, principally to ensure that any provisions work appropriately in Scots law, but the content of those provisions is reserved.
It's reserved. Okay.
From discussions we had, just in general terms with UK government, I think it was their consultation they had with businesses, and I think it was to reduce the threshold for them to report it to the. So I think this is really where the aim of reducing the requirement for a suspicious activity report, where it's pretty clear that it's not actually needed.
Yes, yeah, that's fine. I think that's what my understanding of that was. And if I may, the other point I had, and you may respond in the same way, was around the new powers for law enforcement that will allow them to obtain information to tackle money laundering and terrorism financing. So that's potentially quite a big new power that law enforcement agencies have. So again, it was just a little bit of commentary about that and also whether that incorporates international law enforcement agencies as well.
Yeah, I'm assuming is that in relation to the crypto, mm-hmm. the crypto assets. I think the main powers there for law enforcement is it's allowing them to seize crypto-related items. So before that was not defined. So the law enforcement need to, on a lot of occasions, will need to seize the crypto-related items. Now that could be a piece of paper with a password on it to a laptop. But it's with the aim of them being able to use that item to then gain access to the crypto asset. Mm-hmm. That's the main fundamental point of that.
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much. That's very helpful. We've got, I think, Pauline McNeill wanting to come in, and then I'll bring in Jamie. Pauline.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Trying to take it all in. So I have a few questions I wanted to ask. As a strong believer in devolution, as it always have been, I'm always concerned if the UK government attempt to undermine that in any way or without the consent of the Scottish government. But I wondered what, can you say more about what the rationale is for in this case?
I think, MS, you know, what it reflects is that, as I touched on in my opening remarks, there's a number of these areas cover both reserved and devolved competencies. There's also ensuring that we have a proportionate approach. I would want to say is that you'll be well aware and fully cognisant of the government's position on a range of issues regarding the UK government's approach to devolution. But with regards to this legislation specifically, we've had a very constructive process of engagement, and in following engagement from officials and ministers, we have seen the UK government bringing forward amendments. And while the LCM before doesn't move for consent of all the bill in its entirety, the outstanding areas are areas where we are hopeful through further discussion there will be an opportunity to remedy the outstanding concerns that we have. And indeed, ministers will be meeting with UK counterparts and engaging later on this week. I recognise that where we are now, timescales are tight, but I would say there's been a constructive approach. And what it's seeking to do is to ensure that we respect the devolution settlement and recognising a piece of legislation as complex and indeed as substantial and as long as this will be, there may be issues that arise where there's discrepancies or inconsistencies with the principles that we would want to see upheld. And through a constructive process of engagement with the UK government, we've been able to remedy a number of them. And I'm hopeful that we'll be able to do so with the remainder of outstanding items. Anything you want to add to that, George?
I think Minister's really covered it well there. There is no great policy difference between the administration nor any great constitutional battle here. We're trying to get to a sensible, reasonable position. I think in some cases we've identified in the memorandum areas where, strictly speaking, we could have taken a more purist approach and said, oh no, absolutely we require consent here, but recognising the circumstances in which particular powers are likely to be used, we've opted to say actually simply consulting will be sufficient in this area, because we recognise the shared policy goal of tackling serious crime.
Yeah. Thank you very much. That is really helpful to have that. My second question is unrelated. So a measure removing the statutory fine limit to allow Scottish Solicitors Discipline Tribunal to set its own limits on financial penalties imposed for economic crime disciplinary matters. I wanted to ask you about this because Parliament has traditionally set fines and fees for all sorts of disciplines. The one that comes to mind is accounting and bankruptcy. I personally think there are some, there are some aspects of it's right that Parliament sets this because it's more democratic. You can see clearly how fines are set. I'm not really in principle in favour of organisations setting the fine limit when it comes to crime, because, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, so this is in the context of financial penalties for economic crime and disciplinary matters. I have to thought that's surely a matter for Parliament and not for... if I could just finish on, I certainly would not want to go down this road. I'm opposed to some fees being set by the professions themselves. I think of lots of examples. The reason I don't know about the accounting and bankruptcy is the extraordinary high fees which they set, individuals who are trying to recover from their indebtedness. And I just think it's more democratic to let Parliament decide it. I'm sure there's a reason for it, so I wanted to ask. Thank you.
Well, I recognise the point that you're making. This would create strengthened powers of deterrence, as I touched on in my initial remarks. It would also create parity with the equivalent regime in England, and there are safeguards in place. I don't know, George or Kirsty, where you want to?
I think that's the only thing I would add, is that in England and Wales they have an unlimited fine, so it's just to make it consistent across the board.
One point, the Scottish Parliament will have an opportunity. There's the Regulation of Legal Services Bill that is now before this Parliament, so that would give a further opportunity to examine that issue if the Scottish Parliament wanted to make any further adjustment to the provision. I think we recognise, though, that using the Economic Crime Bill at Westminster actually provides an early opportunity to close a quite significant gap between England and Scotland.
That all sounds perfectly reasonable, but why can't Parliament just set an unlimited fine? What I'm really driving at is the profession itself is going to set the fees for disciplinary matters. And you're saying that is the parity? Was that you're saying that's because it happens in England that English firms set the fines?
Well, it's setting the fine, but it's to strengthen the measures that are in place to act, of course, as a deterrent to the behaviour that we're obviously trying to reduce or minimise.
I'm supportive of that notion. It's just a micro element of that, which is, I'm just asking, why wouldn't you want Parliament to set the fees? Why would you want the profession to set the fees? That's the bit I don't understand. Is that the parity bit with England? So I get the unlimited fines.
Yes.
So
yes.
It makes absolute sense here.
Yes. I'm not aware that any of this provision deals with fees. This is simply around fines, so that where solicitors have in some way facilitated economic crime, that the disciplinary tribunal can give them rather more than a slap on the wrist. We would want to make sure that there isn't any internal market within the UK, that it's easier to get a Scottish solicitor to...
I don't know if I'm making myself clear enough. I'm just going to finish on this. The note I have clearly says... The statutory fine limit to allow Scottish solicitors' discipline tribunal to set its own limits. It doesn't say in parity with England to set no limit. It said to set its own limits on financial penalties. And I would be grateful at some point if I could just clarify, why would you want Scottish solicitors to set their own fines in relation to serious organised crime? I don't understand. Why would Parliament not set those limits?
I think it might be better to deal with this in correspondence, but just this isn't Scottish solicitors setting the fines. This is the discipline tribunal that regulates the profession that is setting them. There is, nevertheless, control through the Court of Session, so there is an appeal route from the discipline tribunal to the Court of Session. So it is not that the fines are uncontrolled in any way.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Jamie Green and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I completely forgot what I was going to ask, but I'll try and pick up the pieces and move on. And I do actually have a second question, which is quite linked to that. The first one is around the petitions to wind up limited partnerships. And I think, if I quoted the Minister correctly, that the Secretary of State can apply to a Scottish court with the consent or support of Scottish ministers, I think was the language used, or Scottish ministers could make a petition themselves. So it sounds like there maybe are two avenues to petition to the Scottish courts. I wondered what the scenario planning had been for any dispute resolution mechanisms whereby the Secretary of State intended to make a petition but ministers disagreed, or vice versa. I know it's a minor technical point and it may never happen, but I just wondered what the process would be to deal with that scenario.
I think in such a scenario the circumstances arising is that with this legislation there is no broad agreement on the policy intent, but there's a need to ensure that the processes for effecting that are consistent with the devolution settlement, so hence the amendments that we requested in the UK government exceeded to around consult and consent mechanisms. I think in such it's difficult to envisage perhaps such a scenario arising. I don't know if you wanted to comment on some of the thinking behind it, George.
Not in great deal. Simply to say that this is the sort of thing that we would expect there to be good liaison between the law enforcement agencies and public bodies, and it's going to come down to a case-by-case analysis of, in a particular case, which body is the one that is best placed to take it forward. It may be a particular case that the Secretary of State and Companies House and other bodies like that have been most closely involved in which case presumably Secretary of State with consent of Scottish ministers would be the best way to deal with this. On the other hand, it might be a case where it's actually been the Civil Recovery Unit at Crown Office here that has been the one that has been leading on the case. So that's the sort of thing where, you know, the law enforcement agencies will work out between them what is the most convenient forum, what is the best way of dealing with it to get the right effect.
I think that's in practice how it would operate, but I'm just conscious of that role now in statute for Scottish ministers allows that direct accountability back to the Parliament, which I know is a particular concern of the Parliament and is something that we have sought to ensure. But I think in practice, as George outlined, in such a scenario arising, there would be a great degree of cooperation and coordination anyway. So I think the issue of a dispute arising in such a context seems remote. But of course, there would be that means of Scottish ministers for their decisions on consent being held to account by Parliament.
That's fair enough. Yeah, thank you for that. And the second is a follow-on from Pauline McNeill's line, a question around Scottish solicitors and regulation around that. Obviously, the government has introduced other legislation, the Legal Services Regulation Bill. And I guess I wondered more generally, what is the Scottish government doing, given that Scotland and England and Wales have both different legal and regulatory systems around both the judiciary and legal services, to ensure that serious organised criminal gangs that do work across borders do not see one particular environment as an easier place to do business than the other? Just a more general policy question on that respect.
Well, as the committee will be aware, the UK government had undertook extensive consultation ahead of this legislation being introduced, but there's been a lot of close engagement between Scottish government officials and UK government officials, particularly in the Home Office. I don't know if George or Kirsty, you want to add anything about the engagement that has taken place with UK government officials on this matter and developing?
Yes, certainly there has been extensive conversations with them. All policy areas, of which there are quite a few, and certainly from our point of view, there's definitely been close liaison to make sure that this works right for Scotland.
Okay. Anything you want to add to that? Thanks. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Russell Finlay and then Colette Stevenson.
Thanks so much. Good morning. I share the convener's view that this bill is absolutely welcome. It's long been clear that Companies House can be abused by criminals, and it's not, you know, some abstract concept involving just overseas individuals or regimes. It matters here in Scotland. It's quite common, in fact, to find multiple Companies House entries for individuals trying to hide their pasts or indeed mask the true ownership of companies, and that includes individuals involved in high-end organised crime such as the drugs trade or VAT fraud. So it's all to be welcomed. But to be frank, this has come to us as a committee at fairly short notice. It's highly complex. Even trying to read the report that we received last night wasn't quite a challenge. And I think the difficulty I have is trying to, well, maybe bring it back to some simple questions and then making the point. And the opening question would be, if the UK government published this bill in September 2022, what's been the delay in getting this to us now?
Well, I recognise the point that you're making, Mr Finlay. This is a challenging timetable in which we're having to operate to, but I think it reflects, you know, broadly, I would say, you know, three elements. One is just the complexity and the nature of the bill itself. It's a very, very long bill. Two is the multilateral nature of engagement that's taken place between Scottish Government at both ministerial and official level. And the third point I'd make is, of course, is this has been subject to a significant number of amendments up to and including at the end of April. So that has meant that in terms of actually achieving, you know, clarity and getting to a position where we can consider the LCM as we are doing today has been challenging. And indeed, the LCM does, as we obviously highlight, and some specific areas where we are still seeking to reach the desired outcome with the UK government. I would add, though, that I think this is just a reflection of a very complex piece of legislation that has been subject to a significant number of amendments.
It does, of course, impinge upon devolved competence, so the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government have had a role in that. And I think it is really just a reflection of that complexity and the volume of amendments and the amount of engagement, constructive engagement, I should add, that has been going on, that has meant it's taken, that we find ourselves in the situation that we are this morning. And, you know, of course, I would accept it. Maybe there's broader lessons that we can reflect on terms of process between UK Parliament, Scottish Parliament, UK and Scottish governments. But sometimes just with a piece of legislation of this complexity, some of that might be unavoidable.
So my next question, which is this the end of the process, is the end of the road? I mean, if we don't agree to this today, or if we is there an option for us to put it on ice and there's still room for negotiation between Scottish Government and UK Government?
We are continuing to engage with the UK Government on these outstanding issues that I highlighted earlier. Of course, the timetable for this legislation will be determined at Westminster, and that is something that we have to, a context within which we have to operate. As regards maybe just, I don't know if Georgia want to comment more broadly on process, on timetabling, where we are and when the bill will reach its next stage in the Lords and Commons.
Yes, I think as the Minister said, there is engagement probably later this week with UK ministers on those remaining small number of outstanding points. Our hope would be that if agreement is reached there and the UK government does bring forward some further amendments to make those adjustments, we would then be able to come forward with a supplementary legislative consent memorandum and indicate agreement to the whole bill. The timescale, though, is not in our hands. Lords Committee has been completed. It will be heading to Lords Report. I don't think a date has yet been set for that. Given the number of amendments that have been made in the Lords, the bill will, of course, have to return to the Commons. So there are still a number of amending stages to go. So we're not quite at the end of the road. Hopefully, this approach will mean that we're able to do this in two bites, you know, today on the main legislative consent memorandum and then a much shorter and simpler supplementary one later. Had we come to the Parliament at a much earlier stage, we would have probably been indicating a much larger number of areas that we still had outstanding issues with and possibly two or three or four, you know, coming back round the course.
This is maybe more of a procedural point for the clerks, but if we don't, if the committee doesn't support the legislative consent motion today, I don't know if that's competent or feasible. We can revisit it. We get time to do so. But
come on to that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Okay. Colette, is that you?
Yes. Sorry. Thank
okay.
You.
Yeah. Sorry. Colette Stevenson.
Thanks, convener, and good morning. I touched upon that you've been in talks with the Home Office in regards to the impact it has on devolved areas. I particularly wanted to focus in on any impact assessment it's had on the charitable sector and Oscar, given that that's a devolved area and it's been known quite widely that charitable sector and also trusts have been widely used for money laundering. I wonder if you could touch upon that.
Yeah, I think that in a way draws attention to where, well, there's the general reservation on business associations. Beyond that, it strays into devolved competency, which has triggered the legislative consent process. I don't know, George, if you want to maybe.
There's not much I can add on that. Certainly from my point of view, dealing with crypto assets, we didn't consult with the Charities Commission. I'm not sure the extent to which the UK government consulted either.
Okay, and the reason why I'm asking, I'm wearing two hats here as the convener for social justice. We're just about to put through the charities bill, and it has been a big focus on Oscar and the reporting aspects of it, so that would have a knock-on effect.
Yeah, and maybe the other policy officials that are dealing with trusts may have had that. We can check that out with them.
Okay.
If there's a specific question, happy to follow up in correspondence just to clarify. I would say the sort of general, sort of broad engagement that took place in the preparation of this legislation was undertaken by the UK government as a UK government bill. But you do highlight an area where devolved competence comes into play, hence the LSDM. But as we've sort of said previously, we generally try to have as much coherence with these regimes right across the UK, given that that is the best way to affect the desired outcome that we all share.
Thank you. No further questions.
Okay, thanks very much. Any other members wish to come in with any questions? No? Okay, on that note, thank you very much, Minister. And we'll just have a short pause to let Minister and his officials leave. Thank you very much. Thanks very much, members. So our next item of business is consideration of any issues for our final report on the LCM. So I'd just like to open it up to members to come in with any issues that you wish to be included in the committee's report to, on the LCM. So I'm just going to open it up to members. Jamie?
I just wonder if the report could reflect that it's clear that there's positive dialogue between the two governments, which is helpful in this scenario given the subject matter, but there are clearly some ongoing, you know, some mopping up to do, which I don't have any particular view on. It's for the governments to decide. Clearly there's been some movement already in some of the amendments proposed by the Scottish Government. I think that's fair and due process. I think the point that Russell made was a very important one, and that's this. It was quite a meaty report, only appeared in our papers this week. It was then followed up very late in the day yesterday with the DPLR report, and it is complex and technical of a nature. I would request, where possible, that we could ask the government to give us advance notice of complex LCMs as far in advance as possible to give members time to read what turned into War and Peace committee papers this week. So I think that would be helpful. It would be perhaps even spend less time in session discussing it.
Thank you very much. Any other comments at all? Nope. Okay. Russell.
Just pretty much to repeat that, but also just to understand what is expected of us today, what our options are. I'm not still entirely clear.
Probably Stephen will articulate that better than me, so I'll hand over to Stephen just to outline some next steps.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. So the question really for the committee in terms of where you stand and timing, at this stage you're being asked whether or not you want to make a recommendation to Parliament on the issue of consent, and specifically the Scottish Government has set out its views as they stand at this point on the provisions that they're recommending consent for those except in one area in the way that the Minister outlined. So this morning you can decide whether you agree or disagree with that, or alternatively perhaps you might decide that you're not in a position to make that recommendation at this point, just given the time you've had available to consider the matter. Mr. Burgess, though, did say that he expected negotiations to be ongoing and that there would be a supplementary legislative consent memorandum to emerge at some point on the negotiations that are still ongoing. So an option might be for you to agree with the government at this point, but await the supplementary legislative consent memorandum and then consider that before making final conclusions on the matters that are still outstanding.
Okay. Bring in Fulton.
Sorry, Stephen, it's almost like your panel. Is that a question for yourself? Based on that last option you said there, if we agree but wait, is that effectively consenting to what was put in front of us today, which is where I would probably want to be, but or is it consenting to it with provisions or with conditions?
To be clear, that the issue of consent is a matter for Parliament as a whole rather than this committee. So it's what recommendation you want to make. So an option available to you is to agree with the government now, agree to recommend consent to the provisions that the Scottish Government is currently happy with, and await the outcome of the negotiations that are still ongoing, and then make your views clear on those provisions when you see the supplementary memorandum. So you'd recommend it, you're with the government at this point, but you await the outcomes of those negotiations and then look to see what the government is saying about those negotiations. The question of when this goes to Parliament, I don't have information to you. That would be a matter for the Bureau. I suspect that the Parliament would await the outcome of those ongoing negotiations rather than agree consent up to a certain point and then have to agree again for what remains. But I don't know that for sure. We'd have to wait to see what the Parliamentary Bureau recommended to Parliament.
Yeah.
I hope that's clear.
Okay. Yeah, no, that's helpful. I think, Colette, did you want to come in? No?
No.
No, no. Okay, thank you. Sorry, I saw your hand up. Russell.
Yeah, thank you. Just come back to what Stephen suggested. I mean, it could be that this is nothing to worry about. It probably is nothing to worry about, but given the complexity and the last-minute nature, it would be nice, I think, if we could have the option that was suggested, which is we agree in principle, but have the option to revisit it once the negotiations have concluded.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Okay, thanks for that. That's helpful. I mean, I think we're broadly all very supportive of the bill, the provisions within the bill, the spirit and the content of the LCM, where it appears that the Scottish Government and UK governments have certainly been engaging regularly and are almost there. I think in terms of the provisions as they impact on Scotland, I agree with the comments that have been made in and around the very tight timescales. There is a lot for us to get our heads around and understand, but I think on the basis that we are in agreement with the direction of travel with this, what I would propose to do is obviously thank you for raising the issues, because that's very helpful for us in terms of what we include in our report. And just so that I'm clear where the committee is, so my question is that if the committee agrees at the moment, at this point in time, that the Scottish Parliament should give its consent to the provisions in the Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill as they've been set out in the draft motion, but perhaps include reference to the fact that we understand that there will be further amendments considered and that they will potentially, in all likelihood, come back for further consideration. So are members in agreement to that? Have I worded that correct? Yeah. No?
Yes.
I
think
so. Is that clear?
If we circulate the text.
Okay. I think what we'll do is, given that this is not just the most straightforward LCM, we'll move on in the agenda and then we can circulate some more helpful wording that I can just cover off in order to be clear where members are in terms of our recommendation and next steps. So are members in agreement with that?
Yes.
Okay. Fulton?
Can I just say, though, just for the public record, that based on what I heard today, both from the Minister, the questions that colleagues asked, the papers and Stephen's explanation, that I'm quite happy with your approach, but I'm happy at this stage as a member to consent to what was asked of today. So I just felt that would be worth putting on the record, but your approach is fine if that's going to lead to a similar conclusion anyway.
Yeah. Thanks. I think we're all on the same page with this. I just want to be absolutely clear with what our recommendation is, and so we'll just come back to that in a moment.
Yeah, circulated by correspondence.
Okay, thank you very much. So we'll move on to our next agenda item, and that is our consideration of follow-up correspondence received as part of our regular review of our action plan and the priorities for reform of the justice sector in this session, and I refer members to paper two. And within that, we have responses from the Scottish Government, the Scottish Prison Service, COSLA, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Criminal Justice Voluntary Sector Forum, and the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. So I'd just like to record our thanks to all those organisations for their comprehensive replies. And so just for ease of reference, I'll go through each of the replies in turn and just open it up to members if you want to make any observations or comments on them. So obviously the first one is the Scottish Government response. Jamie. Russell?
Okay. There's lots in here, but I'm sure others will cover some other ground. In respect of the assessment of the new HMP Stirling and the two new community custody units for women, during our visit to the prison yesterday, we were told that Glasgow University had just been awarded a contract to conduct this assessment work. So it may be that the Minister's response was prior to that being known, but it might just be worth noting or exploring that further. What are the terms of the process and when's it likely to conclude and so on? So okay. I'm assuming it won't begin until July because that's the apparent opening of HMP Stirling. And there's another thing here. It was in respect of the numbers of young people in secure accommodation. Now, I can't remember what we asked. If this is correct, we only asked about numbers that deals with it, page 5. But I thought we'd perhaps ask more around about the funding arrangements, because from the evidence we heard, essentially, if or as and when the provision to not send young people into prison but to use secure accommodation happens, that will put a greater strain on the number of limited number of beds there are. And as a consequence of that, if I understand it correctly, others elsewhere in the UK who are paying more for these beds, it might have some kind of impact on where the funding would come from to subsidise it in Scotland.
But I suppose my only response to that would be, obviously, numbers can change almost sort of day to day or week to week. So, you know, if you're specifically looking for that information, just bearing that in mind.
It's not so much the numbers, which are fluid, it's more just the inevitability of more Scottish spaces being required. And they're paying less. And
the
providers have already given evidence to the effect that this would have an impact on their ability to be viable. So,
we can pick that up. Jamie, I think you were next.
Thank you. This is on the letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice dated 6 April, is that correct? Is that what you want me to comment on? Yeah. First of all, obviously, it's 6 weeks perhaps out of date, so I know we had a lot on as a committee with legislation, so we haven't been able to look at it. So there may be things in here that have been updated since then, so apologies to the Cabinet Secretary if she's watching. The first is obviously the court backlog, and I just wanted to query something, because we've spent a lot of time over the last year or so talking about clearing the backlog as such, but my understanding of the response here is that the intention to clear the backlog essentially means returning to an acceptable backlog rather than what I would consider clearing the backlog as to a net scenario. So the number given here in the paper is that the aim is to return to a point where the number of cases across courts is 20,000. Which I presume would be what is deemed a acceptable pre-COVID level of backlog. And I want to query that because I guess what I'm asking the government is, are they stating, therefore, that a normal backlog would be 20,000 and that's the ambition, to get to that level rather than to actually clear it in any shape or form? So all we're doing is clearing the delta between what was already a backlog before COVID and then how what that was increased to over the period. So I just want to set expectations because we talk quite openly about the issue of clearing backlogs, and I don't think really the public fully understand that what the government's trying to do is not clear the backlog, is simply to get back to what they think is an acceptable backlog, which is 20,000 cases in the system, which is still a lot. And still, there were lengthy delays in the system before COVID. So I don't think that's an acceptable response, actually. I think we should be pushing for a slightly more ambitious approach from SCTS and the government on that. I am aware, and I can't preempt the outcome of what it will say, but I understand that there's a Audit Scotland report on this due out imminently that will give us an update to what is here from the 6th of April. I guess one of the things I'm quite keen to see is where there has been improvement in the clearing of cases, that we look carefully, perhaps even as soon as in the next couple of weeks, as to what that data shows us in terms of the clearing across solemn and summary cases and the cases which are still deemed to be difficult to clear quickly. I suspect, although I haven't seen the report, but that will tell us exactly that those most serious cases, including those of serious violence, murder and sexual crime, are still taking a considerable period of time. And I'll be looking to see what the updated expectation is for clearing those. So I guess that was the first point. Jumping ahead to a point that Russell Finlay raised on the number of young people being held in adult institutions, the response on the 6th of April said that there were 8 under 18-year-olds held in a YOI. A couple of paragraphs down, though, it states that there clearly is occupancy and secure accommodation. So the statistics are helpful, but I guess the wider question is why are there under 18-year-olds in YOIs, of which 7 are clearly on remand, when there are places in secure accommodation? Now, I may be misreading the information we've been given, but that doesn't add up. If there are spaces in either the independent secure accommodation network or otherwise across the network, why there are still people in YOIs that the government doesn't want to be in those places? So I wonder, I know it changes on a daily basis, but there seems to still to be a pattern there which needs to be addressed. On the next page, which is page 6 of our papers, on misuse of drugs, the work on DTTOs, the government talk about the review and the final report on areas for consideration. And it says we expect a report to be published in spring 2023. I wonder if that report has been published since this letter was produced. Maybe we've missed it, or that it's due shortly. My worry is that if we take spring 2023 to be the language of government, then that could be as late as perhaps the last week of June, which is technically, I suppose, when summer starts, which leaves us no time to look at it as a committee between now and September. So I'd be keen to maybe get even an off-the-record track knowledge of when that might be published, and if we could look at it before summer recess, then that would be very helpful. And I think the next point I wanted to raise is around the issue of deaths in custody. On page 7, the Scottish Government said it has no intention to create an online centralised system where delivery of the recommendations can be tracked. There is a short response from the government on that, but it clearly is sticking to that position. I think the problem we have with that is that the families of those who have sadly lost their life in custody are looking for much, much more than one paragraph of a review with respect to Miss Imrie. There cannot be lessons learned if there is no sense. I mean, if this is one of our committee recommendations, there'd be a centralised system of tracking recommendations and progress to recommendations. It seems to be that every time there's an FAI or an investigation into death in custody, many of the same recommendations come out time after time, year after year. Now, we're quite good at tracking progress of the government on whether it's doing what it said it would do, but it's disappointing in this response. I think this response will come as a disappointment to the families who are asking for government to do more and for lessons truly to be learnt. So I'm hoping the government might expand on more of the work that it is doing to give some comfort to those families. And my last point is around legal aid reform, and that's specifically the Legal Aid Reform Bill. Again, the government just says that it's committed to reforming the current system of legal aid and will do so within this parliamentary session. In my conversations with solicitors, they can't wait till 2026 for this reform. There is obviously some temporary measures in place around fees, but that's not a sustainable position, nor does it provide any long-term comfort to those in that profession. So, I'm hoping the Cabinet Secretary could elaborate on what this parliamentary session means from a timetabling point of view, given how busy Parliament and indeed our committee is already, assuming that bill came to this committee. So I'm hoping that will be sooner rather than later in the session so we can do it justice and give stakeholders adequate opportunity to get involved in that process. That's all for this letter. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Pauline and then Katie.
Thank you, Convener. I've got 3 points. First is a continuation of Jamie Green's points, which I wholly agree with. I think what matters here is getting the delay in relation to weeks. So the 95 Act is clear that it's 110 days, 140 days. So anything above that is according to the 95 Act. So I don't really know what... So you can see there's a drop in the number of cases. So it looks like the delay is reducing. But I think the committee needs to see, well, what does that look like? How many weeks, on average, would you be waiting for a rape case, sexual offence case, or whatever in the courts? The second point... It relates to also to Russell Finlay's point, also about her visit yesterday. So it's just my overall impression, and I won't say too much until I've read my notes and considered it in some detail. It was extremely impressive, I have to say, as the previous visits have been. But my concern is 2 points, which I think the committee really need to drill down further into. The first is, the model, in my view, of following the Angelini report could be undermined by the numbers of places within the Stirling estate being 100. Reported as 80, but yes, they were clearly told 100 because they wrote it down. So there's 2 units that have to be assessed, but the report recommended 5. The result of that means that women... Some women, as we discussed yesterday, convener, will be in male jails, albeit in women's wings of male jails. Now, I totally accept there's a geographical dimension to this, Grampian, for example, and I'll say no more than that because it's beyond my knowledge, but I am concerned that it's going to undermine if only a percentage of women end up being part of the estate, which is designed to change the way we treat women. Offending. So I'd like to just lay that concern as something the committee should come back to. Third is, again, same point as Jamie Green about deaths in custody. What is not mentioned in this report, if you go back to it, for me, one of the primary recommendations is for families to have unfettered access to information following a death in custody. So this is really important because FAIs take so long. Many families have complained they don't get immediate access to knowing what happened and to ask questions. So that particular recommendation is really important to families. I guess it's just perhaps a follow-up, convener, with Gillian Imrie. Is it Gillian? Who's chairing it, to ask, well, what conversations is she having? That's my particular interest. But just for completeness, I have asked in the past, and when it's come to Parliament, for Cabinet Secretary to explain how unfettered access to is going to cut across any police investigation. I just say it's not all it's set out to be, because I think it could be problematic, but it's important for families who see that recommendation that it's followed through. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just before I bring in Katie, just to pick up on the points that you made, Jamie, and Pauline, about the backlog. I don't know, and it's something Polly should know, if the backlog means just the number of open cases that are in the court system at any one time, or if I'm interpreting that wrongly. So I think there is maybe some merit in us just clarifying what that is. If it is just open cases, then I would imagine that there has been work done around that figure of 20,000 being a kind of acceptable sort of court workload, if you like, but I'm quite happy for us to check that and confirm that. In terms of your points about YOIs, Jamie, I suppose in terms of the numbers that are in YOI, that would have been a decision of the court, and obviously just the children Care and Justice Bill hasn't been enacted yet, so perhaps there's still a bit of a lag in terms of seeing those numbers starting to change. Happy to check on progress in terms of the DTTO report, which you've flagged. And in terms of your comments on following our visit yesterday, Pauline, I think we did have a helpful discussion with SPS on the models. Obviously, there was reference to an evaluation process that will be coming forward. I think you mentioned that earlier, Russell, in and around the CCUs. My understanding was that would incorporate a sort of wider focus. I could be wrong with that, but I'm happy to sort of track that. And in terms of the points you've made about deaths in custody, I'm happy to follow that up with Jill Emery. Okay, thank you. So I've got Katie and then Rona, and then we'll move on.
Thank you, Convener. And in relation to the secure units, I think the officials did say quite clearly that currently, when they gave evidence, that there wasn't any 16 or 17-year-olds who legally could be moved into secure units because of the disposal of the court. I think it would be helpful to ask confirmation from the Scottish Government that remains the case, and a commitment that that will continue to be the case, that 16 and 17-year-olds will be held in secure units wherever possible. And if for whatever reason that was not possible, if the committee could be advised, if they could write to us to alert us to the fact that there'd been a change. The further point I was wanting to make relates to the issues round about data and women in custody that we've discussed many times. The committee has expressed concern on numerous occasions, both publicly and in our private sessions, about the lack of data that's available to us and the difficulty in us carrying out our scrutiny work when we don't have an understanding of the profile and the nature of the people who are being incarcerated in this country. In relation to women, the intention of the Scottish Government seems to be to reduce the number of women in custody, but the reality is we know that the numbers of women in custody are currently increasing, and there seems to be concern that they are going to continue to increase. So it would be helpful to get more information from the Scottish Government about the profile of women being held in custody and the reasons why there may be an increase. And there might be a range of reasons for that, and I don't want to speculate here as to what they might be, but I do think we need to get an explanation from the Scottish Government as to why that is. It's far from clear whether the bail bill will make any difference to the numbers being remanded. We know, we were told yesterday, that the current figure of women who are on remand within the prison estate is 37%, which is a high level. It's very unclear that the bail bill will make any difference to that, but it would be useful to get information from the Scottish Government as to whether they believe that that legislation will make any difference to the numbers of women being held on remand, and to have an understanding of why it remains the case that so many women are being held within the prison estate. We know that the new custody units at maximum have only had a capacity of 53%, which tells us that at other times they've been less than half full. I think we should be expressing concern about that as a committee. I think we should be writing. I fully understand that this issue is now being raised and that the Scottish Prison Service are looking at the issue, but those custody units have been open since August. The committee were very impressed by what we saw when we went to visit them. There clearly has been a massive investment, both financially, but also in other ways in those facilities, and it's important that they are a success. So I think we should be expressing in the strongest concerns our concerns about the fact that they have not been used to their full capacity, and I think we should be calling for urgent action in relation to that. We know that, you know, people are put in custody because of the legislative framework, but also because of the lack of alternatives to custody. So in relation to the alternative to remand reference group, I think we need a great deal more detail about what the Scottish Government are doing to ensure that there are genuine and robust alternatives to custody. We know, for example, that often people that are given community service orders are not required to carry out the measures that they have been sentenced to. And we need to see a shifting of resources into alternatives to custody if the Scottish Government is going to be successful in enabling the courts to dispose of cases in another way. And we know when we look at the budgets that the money is not being put in there. The direction of travel is in the wrong direction. The amount of money that's being put into alternatives to custody is going down rather than up. And I think we should be expressing in the strongest terms to the Scottish Government the need to shift resources now if they're going to have any success in their stated strategy.
OK, thanks very much. I mean, a lot covered there, and I think you're right, there are positives, there are opportunities and challenges. I note your point about data collection, and that will be relevant to our next piece of work around the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Bill. Note all your comments, extensive comments, in and around the women's prison estate. I think there is a role for the committee, and we'll look to take that forward either as part of our work programme or as an additional piece of work. Just conscious of the time, and we've still got quite a number of pieces of correspondence to work through, so I'll bring in Rona.
Thanks, Convener. I'll be quick. Just agree with a lot, if not all of what Katie was saying there. Regarding the custody units, I have heard that it may be an issue of eligibility and criteria for women to get there. So I think it would be useful to ask, you know, what is that eligibility? Has it been set too high? And, you know, is the criteria, you know, not realistic? But definitely we need to, I would say, definitely chase that up. And Katie's points about remand and data, etc. Absolutely. And I was just to, you know, reinforce, we've talked about the young people in YOIs instead of secure care when there is capacity. So I think that's I can't understand that. So I think it would be useful to find out why that's happening, albeit it might change when the new legislation goes through, but it really shouldn't be happening now anyway. So I'd like that. And the other thing was just to say, the sort of thread running throughout a lot of the responses is reference to reviews and reports being published in spring. It might be helpful for us to have a wee table of stuff, and for yourself to have, I don't want to put more work on the clerks, or maybe Spice could do it, just what's coming or what's late or what's expected, so that we know, because, you know, there's so many reviews and reports which, you know, are just out there. So thank you.
No, that's helpful, Rona. I think just to flag, obviously, one of the things that we covered yesterday was the evaluation on the CCUs that will be coming forward. So I'm sure that's of interest to yourself. note your point about YOIs, and I think that's probably a helpful suggestion in and around just being prepared for what's coming down the line. OK, thanks very much. So we have five more letters to consider and a lot to get through this morning. I absolutely don't want to curtail debate, as you know, but I wonder if I can maybe just ask members if there are specific points of follow-up or remarks that you want to make on the other pieces of correspondence, then I'll bring you in just in the spirit of time. So I think Russell first, then Katie, then Colette. Russell?
I'll be quick, and it's very specific questions. It's relating to the in-cell telephones that are referred to in this letter. Now, the letter's dated April, and it says that all establishments should be completed by the end of April into last month. So it would be useful to know if that's the case. And I think the context is also important. We know that more than £4 million was spent providing mobile phones due initially to COVID. But we also know that this was abused in more than 7,000 different occasions by more than 4,000 prisoners and were also used in the commission of some serious crimes. So I suppose the questions are the cost of the in-cell telephony. Does this replace the mobile phones or will they be running in tandem? I think it's safe to assume it replaces them, but it doesn't actually state that. And if it is the latter, then how much that would cost to run both these schemes? And crucially, I think, given the problems around the mobile phones that we were told would not happen and did happen, what measures are the SPS taking to ensure that the in-cell telephony will not be abused in the same way?
OK, that's noted. Thank you very much. Katie, yes, briefly.
Points relate to the letter from the Scottish Prison Service dated the 26th of April, and again it relates to data. The terms of this letter are very general, but they do relate to areas where the Scottish Prison Service, as I understand it, do have data. When Theresa Medhurst appeared before us on a previous occasion, she said that there was more data that the Scottish Prison Service could provide to us. We can't wait for the Victims Bill to get more data to be able to do the job that we've been tasked with. And I would suggest that we do write to Theresa Medhurst and ask if she could look at what the Scottish Prison Service could currently share with us, because she made it very clear that there was further data that would be available. And my understanding from talking to people within the system is that there is a great deal more data that we've not seen that could easily be shared with us. So I think we should write and make specific requests.
Thanks, Katie. And I think we can maybe have a wider discussion about that in agenda item 6. OK, thank you. Colette, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, it was really on purposeful activity. There's a comment that says that they're undertaking a post-COVID recovery activity review. I would just be keen to follow that up and find out exactly what they're doing. The other thing as well I picked up on, and it includes work placements outside the prison. So that would be relating to the open prison. And it was touched upon before that the open estate had only been used 50% capacity. I'd be keen to know and monitor that and see if that's increased or why it's still not full capacity.
OK, I'm aware that's been a sort of gradual trend in terms of capacity in the open prison estate, so I'm happy to follow that up and ask for a bit more information. Any other points that anybody wants to make on any of the correspondence? Jamie, then. Nope, Jamie.
Yeah, I'll try and rattle through then. So on the letter we've just discussed from Prison Service, I had the same question as Russell Finlay on in-cell telephony. The second is around purposeful activity. There seems to be a bit of confusion as to what I think what the reality is versus what the law says. It very much gives the impression that purposeful activity is available to all prisoners. That was a point that was reiterated actually in last week's bail and release from custody scrutiny, where the Cabinet Secretary, and I just wanted to check the official report, prison rules do not exclude remand prisoners from work or purposeful activity, and the prison service will, where possible, offer access to work and educational opportunities to those on remand. So I just wondered what the reality is on the ground versus what it says in this letter and what we were told. There seems to be, at least, if nothing else, a perception that remand prisoners do participate in much less purposeful activity, including education, counselling, training, and indeed work. I appreciate there's a difference between forcing someone to do work and whether or not sentenced versus someone who's on remand. But I think we just need a bit more clarity around that because it's a bit unclear. It seems to be two different worlds exist there in terms of perception reality. I don't think we can look at correspondence without noting the letter from COSLA, which is quite detailed. They've obviously put a lot of work and time into this in conjunction with their community justice partners. And I think it is quite stark in their letter. It makes it clear through their what we already know through the budget analysis is that practically every other aspect of the justice sector received an improvement in the 23-24 budget compared to the 22-23 budget, with the exception of criminal justice social work, which had a flat cash settlement despite their pre-budget scrutiny warning of the consequences of that. They go into great detail in the letter, which I won't go into, about what those consequences might look like, but it's effectively quite a substantial real terms cut year on year in the criminal justice social work budget. Now, the problem is that they make it clear that that makes it incredibly difficult for them and their local council partners to deliver the Scottish Government's own vision for justice, national strategy for community justice, and, in their own words, widens the existing implementation gap between national policies and local delivery. And I know that sounds like technical jargon, but it's a really important point. It's all very well having a national ambition, but if the people on the ground are tasked to deliver that are saying we can't do it with what you've given us, then there's an issue there. And I'd quite like the government actually to respond in detail to this specific letter from COSLA and local criminal justice social work. I think that this is the sort of letter that the government ought to be replying to them and including us in that response. It's not just a money conversation. It goes into other conversations about workload and people retiring, etc. And the last point was around the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service letter, which was short and sweet. And I note that the Deputy Assistant Chief Officer said that 50% of all operational staff had voluntarily conducted training on overdose awareness and such like. It wasn't quite clear from the letter how many operational staff actually participate in the scheme or carry the pouches with the product administering naloxone. So there must be a difference between those that have done the training and those that actively called the product. It just says that there's clearly been limited progress. Well, 50% doesn't sound like limited progress. So there's clearly a delta between those doing the training and those actually carrying the product. It'd be helpful if they could have been a bit more explicit with that. Slightly nervous by the language that says that a delivery plan will be in place once broader agreement to deploy is confirmed. Agreement with whom? Presumably that would be those frontline workers or indeed their union representatives. It's a bit unclear. I can only read between the lines there. But if they could keep us up to date on that, it would be very helpful. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much. A bit covered there. I'm happy to share the correspondence that we received from COSLA. You're right, it was very comprehensive, it was very, very helpful. Happy to share that with the government, and we can, of course, monitor progress with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in relation to their rollout of naloxone. Okay, thank you very much for those points. I think we've very quickly...
Are we finishing up, or can we refer to these other letters? Or is
there... Well, what I was saying was if you have points, specifically points of action in relation to the other correspondence, if you can just flag them, and then we will note those and
selective.
Take them away.
Yeah, there was one thing in the SCTS letter, page 31, it says SCTS successfully achieved customer service excellence. No idea what that is, but quite good to know. And also, you know, we've asked them about the complaints process and they've told us how wonderful it all is, but there's no data on how many complaints, how they're resolved, are they going up, are they going down, etc. So that might be quite interesting. There's a few other things about COSLA and SFRS, but I'll leave it to now.
Yeah. Close up. Yeah, thank you. Thanks very much. Okay, thank you very much, members. So that concludes our scrutiny of our correspondence on the action plan. So we'll move on to agenda item 5, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the discontinuance of Corton Boyle Prison, Scotland Order 2023, and that's SSI number 132 of 2023. And I refer members to paper number 3. And before we discuss this, I just want to thank Theresa Medhurst and her team at the Scottish Prison Service for a really interesting and informative visit to the new National Women's Prison at HMP YOI Stirling earlier this week. It was really good to visit the prison before it's open and learn a bit more about how it will differ from the previous facility at Corton Vale, in particular around the more trauma-informed and person-centred environment that women will be in once the prison opens. So the purpose of the instrument before us today is to formally discontinue the prison of Corton Vale on the 6th of June 2023, the day the order comes into force. So the discontinuance order is the formal legal act required to reflect that a prison has ceased to operate. So can I ask if members have any recommendations they wish to make in relation to the SSI, which will otherwise come into force? Any comments, Russell?
And then... A very, very quick comment. I also wanted to put on record the appreciation of the trip to the prison yesterday and the official that answered so many questions. It was fascinating. And seeing the new building alongside the old one kind of, I think, contrasts it quite well. But it's also worth putting on record the appreciation of the staff. There was a board in the new prison showing some members of staff of Corton Vale with 40 years service and some 30 and some 20. And so just put that on the record. And also I think it's worth noting that over the years, many women took their own lives in Corton Vale, and just to note that as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Jamie?
First of all, to apologise for being unable to make that. I wonder if the SPS would be willing to host members of the committee who are unable to meet that visit. It'd be very interesting to get a proper tour of it, perhaps once it's operational. I know that makes it slightly more difficult, but certainly there's certainly a willingness amongst members to go back or to attend for the first time. I had a question around, obviously this is a legal SSI, which means that the prison can only be used as a prison, the building itself, the site. I wondered if the government has indicated what its plans are for the building or the wider site, and that may have been answered yesterday. It probably was, actually. I should sort of think some of it.
I think it was, but I've forgotten what it was.
It's no longer being used as a prison.
Who will remember?
What will it do? Just be demolished and government property, or?
Yeah, essentially, as we saw yesterday, on I would say about three quarters of the site, that's all been knocked down and replaced by the new HMP YOI Stirling. There are a couple of buildings that remain of the old Corton Vale, but they indicated yesterday that those two will be removed over the next year and replaced by new parts of HMP Stirling. So essentially on what used to be the same site and the same existing footprint, all the previous buildings relating to Corton Vale are taken down, demolished and replaced by new buildings for HMP Stirling.
I'm sure all that will become clear when I do get to visit. Thank you for that. Cheers.
Yeah, we can certainly follow up on your request in terms of a visit. Thanks. I think it would be very worthwhile for members. Pauline and then Fulton.
Yeah, just to add to what other members have said, it was an excellent visit, and Joan Docherty, who's hosted us twice now, answered like thousands of questions, so I found it really informative. Just for completeness, convener, I mentioned this earlier. We were clearly told there was 100 places, and I just wanted to note for the record that the note we've got says this included a new national prison for 80 women. So there's a disparity of 20 somewhere along the line.
Pick that up.
Thanks.
Thank you. Anne Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. Just like others, I wanted to take this opportunity to put something on the record and what I think is actually quite a historic moment and possibly and hopefully a real change in culture of how we deal with women's custody and justice in Scotland. And obviously Corentin Vale framed it as any involvement in the criminal justice system, either as a user of services or of working in that sector. Corentin Vale is synonymous with Scottish justice and therefore almost a household name, as Russell Finlay alluded to, not always over the years with the best reputation, but that's nothing to do with staff and such like the work there, and I want to put on record my thanks to staff. But I think what we are seeing now is a real change in how we approach women in the criminal justice system, and that can only be welcomed. But given the institution's status in Scottish society, I thought it was important that I also put on record my acknowledgement of that change and my thanks to all staff who have worked there over the years in what must have been some very difficult circumstances.
Thanks, Fulton, and I certainly would also put my grateful thanks to Scottish Prison Service and staff for their commitment over the years at Corentin Vale, and we certainly look forward to hearing about progress as the new facility opens. Okay, thank you very much indeed, members. So that concludes our business in public this morning. We'll now move into private session. We'll take a short comfort break. Thank you.